Hello everyone, this is Dr. Kazi with another exciting video on anatomy. Today, we are going to learn about the seven layers of abdominal wall. Have a look. The outermost thing on your belly or abdomen is the skin. Then we have the superficial fascia, the deep fascia, then the muscles, that is the external oblique, the internal oblique, and the transverse abdominis. And if we look beneath the muscles, we found another fascia, the transversalis fascia, and another fascia, the fascia of the extraperitoneum. That means our abdomen wall is just full of fascia and muscles arranged in a specific order. All right, the last layer is peritoneum. After the peritoneum, we have intestines and the viscera. If you don't understand this boring diagram like I do, so there's nothing to worry about. I have got you. Have a look at this simple diagram. From outer layer to the inner layer, we have skin, superficial fascia, deep fascia, the three muscles, transversalis fascia, the extraperitoneal fat, and the peritoneum. Let us start with the skin of this exotic belly dancer. It's really soft and loosely attached, except this funny portion right here, known as the umbilicus. This scar, which is really attractive, is the attachment site of the umbilical cord. The lines of the cleavage in the skin are constant and almost horizontal. The nerve supply of the skin is by the anterior rami of T7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12 thoracic nerve, and also by the L1 lumbar nerve, which is mainly by the iliohypogastric and the ilioinguinal nerve. The blood which nourishes the skin is by various arteries. The skin of the midline is by superior epigastric and inferior epigastric artery. The skin of the flanks, have a look, which is a region between your ribs and hip, is provided by the branches of intercostal, lumbar, and deep cervical iliac arteries. The remaining skin of the inguinal region is supplied by superficial epigastric, superficial circumflex iliac, and femoral artery. Now, how the blood is drained from the skin of the abdomen? For venous drainage, we have divided the abdomen into two parts, the upper abdominal wall and the lower abdominal wall. Superficial veins form a network around the umbilicus, and this network of veins radiate and pass the blood to the veins, that is lateral thoracic vein, and eventually the blood is drained into the axillary veins and finally into the superior vena cava of the heart. Now, below the level of umbilicus, the blood is drained into the superficial epigastric veins and great saphenous veins, and finally into the femoral vein. All right, we are done with the skin now. Let's study what is beneath this skin. The superficial fascia is divided into two layers, the fatty layer and the membranous layers. Other fancy name for this layer, which I hate, are Camper's fascia and Scarpa's fascia. The fatty layer, as you know, is always thick, and it can be about 3 inches thick in an obese person. The membranous layer, on the other hand, is thinner and fades out laterally and above. In fact, continuous with the superficial fascia of the back and the thorax. Now, what happened to this fascia when it goes down towards the thigh and the penis region? This is really interesting, and lots of weird things happen here. In the region of thigh, it fuses with the fascia of the thigh. known as the fascia latae, the fusion of two fascia is one finger breadth below the inguinal ligament. Now this fascia, remember, we are talking about the membranous fascia, is going down and down. It doesn't fuse with this pubic bone. Continue down toward the clitoris in case of women, and penis in case of men, forming the tubular sheath. After the formation of this sheath-like structure, it enters the wall of subcrotum. Here, name changes again. It's called Camper's fascia. Remember, Camper's fascia only in the region of subcrotum. Posteriorly, it fuses with the perineal body and the perineal membrane. In the next part, we will continue to look what happened to the other layers of the abdomen. Make sure you will like,